the Saturday was silent, and surely it was through. Since when has impossible ever stopped you? And Friday's disappointment, and Sunday's empty tomb. Since when has impossible ever stopped you? Oh, this is the sound of dry bones rattling. And this is the praise make a dead man walk again. And open the grave, I'm coming out. I'm gonna live again. And this is the sound of dry bones rattling. Pentecostal fire, yes, sir.
Drop on down. morning.
Wow, wow, wow. My word. Lord, you are glorious, and we thank you. We thank you for the opportunity to be in this place and to worship you and to celebrate this, Lord God, the most amazing day that comes in our year. The reality that you, Lord, have risen, that you have taken control, Lord God, and that we get to live eternally with you. God, I am not worthy, but I've been chosen. And Lord, I thank you for that. Thank you, thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen, amen. Welcome to Easter morning, everybody. Oh, man. This is an amazing, amazing day, and we want to welcome you. We want to thank you for being here this morning. So what we're going to do right now, and this is going to be a little bit of chaos. How many of you love chaos? Yeah, I do not love chaos, but this is going to be fun, all right? I'm going to ask you all to stand up, if you would, please. All right, stand up. And I want you to look around because I know, everybody say, I know. There are people here that you do not know, all right? So I want you to get out in the aisles, and I want you to take a few minutes and shake some hands, get to know somebody you might not know. And I want you to remember, today the day we say, he is risen. He is risen indeed. Amen. Let's do this morning. Amen. You serve a God. Amen. That's it. You serve a risen Savior today, and we celebrate with you in that. I have a couple announcements that I want to make, but we're going to watch this video really quick. If you would turn your attention to the screens. Talking over the last few weeks about our One Day to Feed the World offering, and today is the day, all right? Yes, let's get excited. Pastor has given me the privilege to be a part of the Convoy of Hope team to be able to promote it here at our church, and we chose Easter Sunday because if you know anything about Convoy of Hope, they are about they're investing into people so they can rise up out of tragedy or rise up out of poverty to have a life that is new and is revived. Amen. So yeah, I fumbled a little bit there, so it's fine. All right, Roger's going to be okay today, everybody. All right, let me tell you a couple things about Convoy of Hope. One semi-truck load of food, all right? Everybody imagine one semi-truck load of food. It costs $40,000 to buy that semi-truck full of food. Now, you're thinking, man, that's a lot of money, but think about it, that's a lot of food. And if from that one truckload of food, they can feed up to 20,000 people. So for $40,000, we can feed 20,000 people. That is amazing. That is an amazing statistic. $120 can feed a child for an entire school year. $120. How many of you have fed your child this last year for $120, right? How many of you this last week your child ate $120? Yes, exactly. That's how life goes. But for $120, you can feed a child for an entire year. For between $300 and $500, depending on the area, we have to be conscious of that. Between $300 and $500, it can empower a mother to learn how to do the necessary things to be able to feed her family for a lifetime. It's an investment into a person, helping them to understand what it takes to be able to feed their family for a lifetime. One day offerings, we've been talking about it. It's very simple. We take our salary over the year, whatever that is, and there's, oh, Pastor Roger, I'm hourly. So you just take what you make in a year, you divide it by 365, and we're asking that you would give that amount of money. Normally, pastor says, listen, whatever the Holy Spirit tells you to give, that's what we want you to give, because that's what's most important, obedience, right? But this is one of those times where there is actually an equation that we can take, and we can plug numbers in. How many of you like numbers? Yeah, me either, all right? But you could plug numbers in, and it's very, very simple to do. So we've been talking about it for the last few weeks. We've been telling you that today is the day, so listen up, everybody. Today is the day, all right? So if you are going to be participating with us in the one-day offering, in the back of your seat or the seat in front of you, there's an envelope there, and it says one day. If you're going to put cash in there, that is fantastic. If you're going to write a check, please write the check out to LaPorte Assembly. We will send one check in its entirety. None of the money that you give will stay here in LaPorte. It will go in its entirety to Convoy of Hope, all right? But we just want to send them one check instead of sending them dozens of checks, all right? It's just simpler for everyone in that. We also have it online. If you go onto our church app, you can, when you're getting ready to give, you can twirl down, and there's a deal that says Convoy of Hope. Simply pick Convoy of Hope, put in your amount, and then finish that transaction. And we want to thank you for your participation. Last year, you ready for this? This is very cool. Last year, from this church, we were able to give $37,000. All right? And I would love to say that's because I'm a great communicator. I would love to say it's all because of me, but that is not truth. It's because you are an incredibly generous congregation. Wow. Man alive.
I'm really glad you're not preaching today.
There are people clapping at that, Pastor. That's very offensive to me.
Wow. There are also
and
people.
In my home group, nonetheless. That hurts. It does hurt. I'm going to kick this can right now. No, we want to thank you for being a part. You are so generous, and we want to encourage you. I think we can do, I feel like we could buy a truckload this year. I feel like we could invest the amount of money that it would take to feed 20,000 people. What's my problem, babe? My wife says, just shut up. Just stop talking and it'll all be better. All right? 20,000 people. We can do that, folks. I believe that we can do that. So again, throughout this service today, if you wouldn't mind writing out your check, throwing them in these buckets here, go online and do that online. I believe that we can do that. Amen? All right. I have a couple more announcements. I don't know if you noticed when you came in out in the foyer, there's a photo booth set up. We try to do that for a special occasion. So when family comes together, we can take pictures, because how many of you ever recognize that someday you're going to want to have access to those pictures, right? You're going to want to be able to look back and say, wow, look at how ugly my dress was. No, I'm kidding. That was terrible. I don't wear dresses. All right. That was the funny part, but forget it. Last year I didn't have hair. This year I might have a little hair, so it'll be different, right? But it's an opportunity for you to just take a couple minutes, stand there with your family, have somebody take a picture of you. We have a team that comes in and they put that together, and we are very, very grateful for the hard work and the effort that they put into making that happen. And then I have one final announcement. We're going to get right back into our time of worship. Is that all right? All right, one final announcement. So last week, we talked about the evangelism class, and we had talked about the sign-up being posted, and that, again, will happen this week, midweek. If you are interested in being a part of the evangelism class, that will be up on our website and on our church app in the middle of this week. Everybody understand?
Yes.
All right. I'm going to stop talking about that stuff now. And today, we're going to just spend some time in God's presence. Amen? We celebrate because he sacrificed. Friday, we talk about the sacrifice that Jesus made. It's unfathomable to us. The longer you're around it, the easier it is to just kind of allow it to become part of what we know in the back of our mind, but it's not really forefront. The things that Jesus suffered in order that Roger can have his sins forgiven. In order that all of those things that I do have done, he can look at and he can say, Roger, it's not okay and it's not right. But in my blood, you are forgiven. Today, we get to sit in this room and we get to say, Lord, sin separated me from you. And there was no way I could make my way back to you. But you sent your son and he died. You sent him to live a sinless life. And he died on a cross in order that I can be restored to you. He died on a Friday, but on Sunday morning, that tomb was empty. Because he is the authority. Because he is the power. Because he is the Savior. So today, I want you to give everything you got. All right? I want that every week. But of all days, let's hold nothing back, because today your Father deserves your praise. Lord, we are so grateful. Easter, Lord, we look forward to this day all year long. We are so grateful. You gave your life, Jesus, because of my sin. But you rose from that grave with authority. You have restored my relationship, and today I stand in awe of you. In Jesus' name.
Oh, we serve a risen Savior, amen? And he's in this room today.
In the darkness we were without light, till from heaven you came running. There was mercy in your eyes to fulfill the law and prophets. To a virgin came the word, from a throne of endless glory to a cradle in the dirt. till that stone was moved for good. All for the Lamb had conquered death, and the dead was from their tombs, and the angels stood in awe for the souls of all who come to the fire are restored, and the church of Christ was born, and the Spirit in the flame. Now this gospel truth the Lord shall not kneel, and it shall not fade. I put in His name, in His freedom I will pray. For the love of Jesus Christ, hold every breath, and so I'm
excited to introduce this song to you this morning. It's gonna be it blew our mind as we were rehearsing it, and it's been around for a little while, so you'll probably know it once we play it. But worship with us as we sing this morning.
Thank you.
into glorious light.
Close out our worship set with this great hymn.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now.
Was grace
that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear, the are gone, I've been set free.
sinful selves were crucified with Christ so that sin might lose its power in our lives. We are no longer slaves to sin. For when we died with Christ, we were set free from the power of sin. And since we died with Christ, we know we will also live with Him. We are sure of this because Christ was raised from the dead, and He will never die again. Death no longer has any power over Him. When He died once to break the power of sin. But now that He lives for the glory of God. So you should also consider yourselves to be dead to the power of sin and alive in God through Christ Jesus. Amen? Amen. He is risen. He is risen. Welcome to La Porte Assembly of God. You can be seated this morning.
Lord, one more time, we thank You because You are so good. Lord, we get to live free because of You. Lord, today it's easy for us to forget. Lord, there are times when we forget. But today is a day that is a reminder. And today, Lord God, we live in victory. Stay here, Holy Spirit. Be a part of what we're doing today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Well, good morning and happy Resurrection Sunday. Thank you for making a celebration, coming to La Porte Assembly as part of your celebration this morning. I have to say, this is like one of those days of the year that I demonstrate to you that I actually can stand and preach, and I know how to tie a double Windsor tie, okay? It's also a day in which it is blazing hot in here. Listen, the AC is down lower than I normally have it, okay? Two things. We have extra people, so there's more BTUs, and I'm wearing a suit. You know, I need to go back to where I just wore Hawaiian shirts, man. That was better. It's always exciting because we have people that, you know, some of the kids come home. Great to have those adult kids home for the holiday. Cody, man, nice. Thanks for showing up at church today, man. Appreciate that. That's always awesome to have guests come in. I love it. People get displaced. I saw the basketball team got moved out of their normal seats. That's okay. And then we have Jim and Lori Gippert with us this morning. Man, that is awesome. What an honor to have them. They were a phenomenal blessing to our community and to the body of Christ when they pastored here in town. And, you know, some of your folks immigrated over here. They did it legally. And but it's really just, they really didn't have much choice. They were like, well, we've searched, we shopped around. That's about the best we can get, man. You're loved and respected, and we miss you around here. Easter is an incredible day. The whole concept, the whole thought of that story, if you sit back and try to wrap your mind around that whole story, it's really quite remarkable. And you know, there's something that happens in our relationship with God. You know, we sing songs about the miracle power of God and the supernatural things of God. And God is miraculous and He's supernatural. But there are times that even when we're dealing with the one true God of all creation, the one who created everything that exists, the one who sustains everything and holds it together, there are times, despite His unlimited power, we find ourselves in positions of waiting. You know, the Easter weekend was a weekend of waiting. You know, on Good Friday, Christ went to the cross and was crucified. They took Him down and they buried Him. And for 3 days, there was waiting. The apostles really didn't know what they were waiting for. They just knew the one that they had given their entire lives to was dead. He was buried and sealed in a tomb. And they were waiting for what was going to come next. And there are times when God is going to perform a miracle that we're on that side of, we're in that position of waiting on God. You know, in the book of John, there's several miracles that we read about. In John chapter 2, verses 1 to 11, we read about Jesus' first miracle that he performed. He turned water into wine. And when we see God perform miracles, we're learning something about the character of God. And Jesus turned that water into wine, and we see that God has he's got a hospitality about him. He's gonna take care of the comfort needs of his people. There's also something very important about Jesus performing this miracle at a wedding. Jesus is demonstrating the sacredness of the marriage covenant, that he was blessing that union. In John chapter 4, verses 43 to 54, we see the healing of a nobleman's son. And it's important that we understand this was a nobleman's son. This was a person of stature. This was a person of position. This was someone that was respected within his community. But the thing that really is revealed about Jesus performing this miracle was that Jesus wasn't physically present with the son. He healed him without ever being physically in his presence. That demonstrates that God operates outside the limits of space. That's why we can be praying for people all around the world and God is moving. That God's not limited to like human beings are. There's no limitations of his abilities to be anywhere. In John chapter 5, we read verses 1 to 14, we see the story of the healing of the paralytic. You know, this man that was crippled from birth. Now you have to imagine this guy. He has no muscle tone. His joints are frozen solid. He has no ability to move and to walk on his own. And Jesus healed him. And it demonstrates that God operates outside of time. Because the miracle was that it was an instantaneous, miraculous healing. The muscles were no longer atrophied. The joints were no longer locked frozen. Jesus healed him, and he instantaneously was able to get up and walk. There was no time required for a process of healing. In John chapter 6, verses 1 to 15, we see the feeding of the 5,000. And that's 5,000 men. We don't know exactly how many people were there. It could go as high as 20,000 people. But Jesus took a few fish and a couple loaves of bread, and he fed this vast multitude. It shows that God not only has a gift, a heart for hospitality, but he also meets our tangible needs when we're in that place that we need him to do that. In John chapter 9, verses 1 to 40, we read the story of the healing of the man born blind. And again, Jesus instantaneously heals this man, and it demonstrates that he operates outside of the bonds of natural human limitations. Because let's understand what happened. This guy was blind. And so not only did his eyes begin to function, but there's all this neurological process that had to begin engaging as well, so his eyes could see and his brain was processing what he was seeing. It was this instantaneous supernatural healing. And then in John chapter 11, verses 1 to 43, it's the raising of Lazarus from the dead. This was a foreshadowing of what was going to take place in Jesus' very own life. You know, the thing we need to understand about the times that Jesus performed miracles is that his heart was moved with compassion. He saw people in need. He saw people suffering. He saw them hurting. He was moved by compassion to bless them and move on their behalf. Now think about it. We believe in God, that we serve a God who works miracles. We believe in the miracle working power of God. But if you are a rational person, you never want to be in the position where you need a miracle. Where you're in that position where you need a miracle, that's a place where you are filled with worry and anxiety. When you're in a position waiting on a miracle, you are gripped with fear and torment. You're in a place of desperation. Nobody wants to be in that place. But when we are in that place, we have a tendency to seek after miracles. We're not to seek after miracles. We are to seek after the miracle worker. Jesus said this in Matthew chapter 6, verse 33, and this is just Jesus teaching about how God will meet all the needs of his sons and daughters because he cares for us. And we are instructed to seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added to you. So when you're in a position where you really need God to work in your life, you have a desperate need, and you're filled with that anxiety, and you have those concerns, and you just feel desperate, don't look at the need being met. Just keep seeking after God and watch God work on your behalf. You know, when we look at this story of Lazarus, picking it up in John chapter 11, verse 21, Lazarus has died, and Jesus knew he was dying, and he really didn't rush to get there. And he finally arrives, and Martha said to Jesus, "Lord, if only you had been here, my brother would not have died. But even now I know that God will give whatever you ask." Jesus told her, "Your brother will rise again. Yes, he will rise when everyone else rises at the last day." Jesus told her, "I am the resurrection and the life. Anyone who believes in me will live even after dying. Everyone who lives in me and believes in me will never die. Do you believe this, Martha?" Man, that's the Easter story. This week, the Allen family lost the matriarch of the family. This week, my neighbor called and said that her mother had just died, and they lost the matriarch of their family. And those are sad moments. We've lost irreplaceable people. But both of these women knew Christ as their Savior. And although we've lost them here on this earth, we have the hope of the resurrection to live eternally in Christ Jesus. That is the hope of Christianity. That is the hope of the gospel. That's why we celebrate on Resurrection Sunday. So when you're in that position where you're waiting, do you believe? Do you believe that God will provide? When you're in that position where your marriage is faltering and you are on the brink of divorce, do you believe? When you get that diagnosis that it's incurable, do you believe? When you're at the bedside of that loved one that's about to enter into eternity, do you believe? When your children have walked away from the faith, do you believe? In those real world situations where we really need God to enter in and intervene, do you believe? Here's something that I understand about believing in God. Believing in God also comes with doubts. Because life teaches us that things don't always turn out the way we'd like them to. We know a lot of stories where that didn't end with the happily ever after. But in the midst of waiting on God, do you believe? I want to encourage our church family, in your prayer time, if you would remember our pastor's wives. All four of them are going through health challenges. They're going through situations that require medical interventions and various therapies, and some of their situations are more serious than others. But it's curious to all of us that all four of our wives are going through a physical battle at this point in time. And we're in that place, we're waiting. We're waiting to hear what diagnosis come forth. We're waiting to see the success of therapies. We're waiting for God to extend his hand of healing and touch each of them. And so I just encourage you, in your prayer time, would you remember our pastor's wives and lift them up? You know, in that place of waiting, it's common to struggle. It's natural to struggle when you're waiting on God. The disciples, they struggled while they were waiting. They weren't certain what was going on. You know, even after Jesus had manifested himself, there was still, we still have the story of their struggle, their doubt, or their wondering what's going on here. In John chapter 20, picking up with verse 24, One of the 12 disciples, nicknamed the, Thomas, nicknamed the twin, was not with the others when Jesus came. Man, that would be the story of my life. Jesus would show up and I was like, you know, getting a snack or something, you know? They told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he replied, "I won't believe it unless I see the nail wounds in his hands, put my fingers into them, and place my hand into the wound in his side." And I think, man, Thomas, do you think all your buddies are lying to you? Yes, he did. He didn't believe them, but he wanted evidence. So 8 days later, the disciples were together again. And this time, Thomas was with them. The doors were locked. And suddenly, as before, Jesus was standing among them. "Peace be with you," he said. I got to tell you, if Jesus physically, visibly, tangibly came into this room and stood before us, I would want him to say, "Peace be with you," because I'm going to be a little freaked out, even though I look forward to seeing him, man. It's just, that hasn't happened to me. Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here. Do you see God?" He knew exactly where Thomas was at. He knew exactly what his thoughts were. "Put your finger here. Dude, I don't want to put a finger in anybody's wound." "And look at my hands. Put your hand into the wound in my side. Don't be faithless any longer. Believe. My Lord and my God," Thomas exclaimed. Then Jesus told him, "You believe because you have seen. Blessed are those who believe without seeing." In our lives, there's a lot of times, there's a lot of moments, we all have them, no matter where we are at in our maturity and faith. There are times that we wish there was something tangible that we could touch, see, and feel about God. We've all been there. But look what Jesus said. We never got to see him physically. But he said, "We are blessed because we have enough faith that we believe without ever visibly, tangibly seeing him." Let's go back to the Lazarus story. John 11. Jesus told her, "I'm the resurrection and the life. Anyone who believes in me will live even after dying. Everyone who lives in me and believes in me will never die. Do you believe this, Martha?" "Yes, Lord. I have always believed you are the Messiah, the Son of God, the one who has come into the world from God." Martha believed that Jesus was the Christ, he was the Messiah, he was the Savior before he raised her brother from the dead. Before she saw the miracle, before she saw the sign, before it was physically, tangibly before her, she believed. And that is what God is asking for each of us, that we would believe, to believe this story. There's a miracle I didn't talk about. You read about it in Luke chapter 8. It's the woman who had the issue of blood. And because she was a woman of some means, she had spent, if not all her fortune, the vast majority of her fortune, seeking medical aid to stop this bleeding. In the Jewish culture, she was ostracized from the community because she had this blood, so she couldn't be among her Jewish family. She had no one and she had nothing. And she was waiting on God. And in her desperation, she reached out and she just touched the hem of Jesus' garment, and instantly his virtue left her and she was healed of that which she had endured for 12 years. You know, it shows us something. It shows us that God is not limited to our religious traditions and our way of thinking. Where the Jewish law excommunicated her, that didn't matter to him. He had compassion. He cared about a woman who was in need. In her faith and her desperation, she was healed. There's something about that story that resonates with me because it shows that there are times that we feel rejected by others. We don't feel desired. Other people don't want us. But God accepts us. He takes us. I've shared with you before in my previous life, nobody wanted me around their wives. Nobody wanted me around their children. They didn't mind partying with me. They didn't mind getting into barroom brawls with me as long as I was on their side. But they didn't want me around their families. I know what it's like to not feel wanted and apart. You know, I appreciate so much the transformation that God makes in our lives. A couple weeks ago, Liz was here making decorations for Easter, and she had Ryla with her, and Ryla is preschool. And I got to interact with her a little bit, and she was with her mom, and she made some bouquets out of fake flowers, and she said, could I show those to that big guy? You know, for me, it's just a reminder of how God changes us. He makes all things new. That however I was in my past, that's all gone. The new creation in Christ Jesus. Now, I've shared with you, I got saved on April 18th, 1982 at Hobart Assembly of God. It was a day that I can never forget. It changed my life. It was a demarcation line in my life. I was one way when I went to church, and I was a different way afterwards. And I didn't realize how different I was going to be. But I remember the sermon. I remember what I told people after I got saved. Don't expect any big changes from me. And I remember I went to work that evening. I remember that day so clearly. This morning, that was 42 years ago. This morning, for the first time in my life, I was thinking, what did I do for Easter that year? I got saved on April 18th. When was Easter? And I looked it up. It was April 11th. I went to church on April 11th. I went to the Easter service. I don't remember that day at all. I don't remember anything about it. I don't remember going to church. I don't remember what I did after church. I don't remember if I had Easter dinner with my family. I don't know if I worked that night. I don't remember anything about it, except I didn't really like the preaching. It just wasn't impressive to me. And that pastor, he became my pastor. And he became some of your pastors when he left Hobart and came to LaPorte to pastor here. And what I know about that Easter service, because I know Pastor Faulkner, that was back in the days where he had choirs and you had church cantatas. And we had a very talented church, and I am absolutely convinced there was spectacular music and songs that took place there. I don't remember any of it. I just know that I was at church motivated by the woman I was dating who invited me to go to church. I don't know why you're here today. I don't know if you're here because somebody invited you to come to church and you felt an obligation to come. I don't know if you're here because it's Easter and it's a special Christian day and so you're going to come to church. I don't know if you're trying to impress somebody. And I'm quite confident there are some people here, they would like to be anywhere but here right now. Would you just give me a few minutes of your time? Because I don't want you to leave here today and miss what I had undoubtedly missed when I went to that church service on that Easter morning. Why should you believe this incredible story? Why should you believe this epic tale of God creating everything that exists? And out of everything he created, the crowning glory of his creation was humanity. He loves human beings more than anything else he created. And man rebelled against God. Man sinned against God. And because of our sin, we lost our relationship with God. And the story of the Bible teaches us that we were powerless, helpless to do anything about our spiritually lost condition. We couldn't follow religious rules or rituals or regulations in order to have a right relationship with the one who created us again. But God never stopped loving us. And he made the way possible for our sins to be forgiven through this amazing story of his son being conceived supernaturally. And that the son was born and lived a perfectly sinless life, and even though he was living in this world with human flesh on, that he innocently went to the cross and died a brutal, horrifying death, and his blood came out of his body to pay the price of our sin. That he was paying the price for us to be forgiven, for our bondages of sin to be broken off of us. That same son was put into a tomb and had a heavy stone rolled in front of it, and it was sealed and guarded by Roman soldiers. And he was in that tomb for 3 days. And in miraculous supernatural power, God raised him to new life again, resurrection power. And that same Jesus had the ability to walk into rooms that were locked and secured. He went around for 40 days revealing himself to a multitude of people. And in the witness of dozens of people, he ascended into heaven. They watched him go up into heaven. And he sits at the right hand of the Father right now, and he intercedes for us. This incredible story that says, listen, you are separated from God. You have no hope outside of this gift of Jesus Christ dying on the cross. That we are required to repent of our sin, to ask God to forgive us of sin, and bring Jesus into our life to be our Lord, our Savior, the ruler, the master, the one in control of our lives. Why should you believe that incredible story? Why should you do that? Paul was writing to the church at Corinth, and in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 14, he says, if Christ has not been raised, then all our preaching is useless, and your faith is useless. If Jesus didn't rise from the dead, all the sermons I preached to you are nothing but vain communication. If Jesus didn't rise from the grave, then all of your faith in Christianity is useless. The basis, the foundation, the thing that makes our faith certain and sure is that Jesus rose from the grave. He literally did it. Why should you believe that? I believe you should believe it because the Bible is a reliable collection of historical documents. The Bible is a reliable collection of historical documents. The events of the Bible actually took place. They were written by eyewitnesses during the lifetime of other eyewitnesses. There are people who saw these things happen, and they saw it together with other people, and they documented historically what had taken place. They report supernatural events that took place to fulfill specific prophecies. That you have dozens and dozens and dozens of prophecies that all point to Jesus Christ as the Messiah. And they claim their writings are divine rather than human in nature. The authors of the Bible never claimed that they were writing this for themselves, that they were writing as led by the Holy Spirit. Now, there is something that I know. I know that there are ancient pagan tales that seem very similar to the stories of the Bible. You know, they come out of Egypt and other cultures. And skeptics will say, isn't the biblical narrative, isn't that just copying earlier mythologies? No, there's a huge difference. Those mythologies did exist, but they never point to a historical person. They never talk to historical events that actually took place. That is what separates the scriptures. The scriptures are talking about literal people, literal events that took place, and it's historically documented, and it's never been proven to be wrong. Every archaeological dig has proven the accuracy of scripture. So where do I come up with this idea? Not that I came up with it originally. I stole it from somebody else who probably stole it from somebody. But where do I come up with this idea that the Bible is a reliable collection of historical documents written by eyewitnesses during the lifetime of other eyewitnesses? They report supernatural events that took place in fulfillment of specific prophecies, and they claim their writings are divine rather than human origin. Where do I come up with that? Well, my brother-in-law, John, I'm going to tell you, John, turn to 1 Peter chapter 1, verses 16 to 21. And I just say that to John because I know he'll watch and he takes notes and he highlights his Bible, and I love it. This is Peter. We were not making up clever stories when we told you about the powerful coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. We saw his majestic splendor with our own eyes when he received honor and glory from God the Father. The voice from the majestic glory of God said to him, This is my dearly loved Son, who brings me great joy. We ourselves heard that voice from heaven when we were with him on the holy mountain. Because of that experience, we have even greater confidence in the message proclaimed by the prophets. Above all, you must realize that no prophecy in Scripture ever came from the prophet's own understanding or from human initiative. No, these prophets were moved by the Holy Spirit and they spoke from God. I never want you to come to church for any reason out of a sense of obligation. Somebody invited you. It's a special holy day. I should show respect and come to church. Because I got to tell you, God doesn't, that doesn't matter to him. I remember when Roger Elliott came to church on an Easter. And I made the comment, not to Roger, but just to anyone. You know, if you came to church because it's Easter and someone invited you and that you're just going through some empty religious ritual, you're just wasting your time. And I remember Roger was not happy with me about that. But it turned out pretty good for him. He got saved, born again, and serving Jesus, so that's all right. I never want you to come to church at any time out of a sense of obligation or duty, begrudgingly. It's just empty, perfunctory religious ritual. It doesn't mean anything. What I want you to do is really evaluate, why should you believe this incredible story, this remarkable story? You should believe it because it is absolutely true. It has been documented to be accurate in all its teachings. And you need to hear the message that every human being is separated from God because of our sin. And some may say, I'm not that bad a person. I wasn't like you were, Jeff. You were bad. You needed to get saved. I get it. No, there's none righteous, not one before God. Doesn't matter how good a life we live. We need to have our sins forgiven. That only happens when we repent of sin, receive Christ as our Savior, and dedicate ourselves to living the rest of our lives for him. So on this Resurrection Sunday, do you believe this story? Have you put your faith in that resurrection story? Have you put your faith in the one who rose from the grave? If not, today's a great day. With a clear mind and a pure heart, not being emotionally stirred or coerced into it, but to say, today, I do believe that story. Today, I ask my Father God to forgive me of sin. Today, I ask Jesus to be my Lord. Would you bow your heads and your hearts? Father, thank you for today. God, thank you for that day that we specifically pause and reflect on that stone being rolled away. We think about that story of the women first, and then the apostles going to the tomb and seeing that it was empty. We think about that story where Jesus begins to reveal himself to the apostles, and then to dozens and hundreds of other people, proving without a doubt that he was raised from the dead. Showing us with all certainty that he indeed is the way, the truth, and the life. No one can come to you except through him. Verifying that we are not forgiven of our sins because of our religious traditions, but we become new creations when we acknowledge that we're separated from you because of our sin. When we believe in the work that Jesus did on the cross, that paid all the penalty of our sin. Father, it's not a matter of us getting our act together and improving ourselves. It's a matter of us just coming to you just the way we are. And God, thank you that we might come to you like myself. I was a total mess. But you didn't leave me in that mess. You changed me from the inside out. God, I thank you that you are no respecter of persons. God, you perform miracles for a nobleman and for a lowly woman who was ostracized because she was unclean. You perform miracles to people that were deaf and blind and lame. You are not a respecter of persons. You're filled with compassion. And today, God, the greatest miracle can take place is that a soul could be born again. If you're here this morning and you've never really embraced the story of Easter, you've never fully given yourself to this good news of Jesus Christ, today would you do that? Right where you're at, would you have a conversation with God? Say, God, I've heard what Jeff said. He's saying, and I believe it, that the Bible is accurate. It's historically accurate. There were dozens of prophecies that were specifically fulfilled by Jesus. And he really did rise from the dead. He really is the way to you. And so, God, would you forgive me of my sins? And Jesus, would you come and really be the Lord of my life? Would you begin leading my life? And cause me to be that person I was put on earth to be so I could go forth and do those things which I was ordained to do. All across this room, just have that conversation with God. Say, God, forgive me. Thank you for Jesus. Thank you for Easter. Thank you for the resurrection. God, for those of us that are more seasoned followers of Christ, God, I pray we never lose the awe of the resurrection. We never lose the wonder of the story of Scripture. God, that we never lose sight of its accuracy, the truthfulness of it, and how the principles of that word still apply to our lives today. And Father, in this place this morning, there are many people that are in that position of waiting. They're waiting. They have aging parents whose health is declining and abilities are declining. There are those that are waiting, going through medical procedures to get a diagnosis of what's going on in my body. There are those that are waiting for therapies to be effective and for health to be restored. There are those that are waiting for a relationship to be healed. There are those that are waiting for provision to be made. There are those that are waiting for sons and daughters who have strayed from the faith to come back home. God, for those of us that are in that season of waiting, God, may we seek you in that season. God, it's so natural for us to seek the manifestation of that answered prayer, so natural for us to seek after that miracle. God, would you just help us to seek after you? And know as that we seek after you, you're gonna come through. You're gonna get peace. You're going to give healing. You're going to give provision. You're going to give strength. And you're going to give wisdom. And you're going to give discernment when the situation doesn't go the way that we would desire it to go. And God, you're never going to leave us nor forsake us. You're going to be with us always. Now, God, I pray that you have heard the hearts of every person here this morning. And God, I pray that whether it's online or here physically, that there's somebody who's truly embraced the Easter story. Now, God, as we leave this place, may your spirit abide with us. God, may we leave here filled with joy in knowing that we are serving the risen Savior. May we leave this place and live in a manner that we represent you well to the community around us. God, we commit this all to you in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you. Happy Resurrection Sunday. Let's go have a great day.